You can turn your Bibles, and I'm going to do something different today. I decided to preach, I've never preached on this topic, but what it looks like to be a Christian in South Africa. Amen? Being a Christian in South Africa. Now, you can turn your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 2, and I'm going to read for you verse 13-15. Okay, please summon this dog. Needs to go. It's the neighbor next door's dog, and he's a bit of a... He's a very friendly. He's been here the whole morning terrorizing us. And just take him... Okay, if you can keep him intact, that should be fine. Under control. Being a Christian in South Africa, let's read together in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme, or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil, and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for your precious word. I thank you, Lord, that we have this time of fellowship, that we can open your word, that we can hear what you want to say to us. I pray that you'll bless these words to every heart. May we adhere to your will. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Now, there's a lot of talk, you all know, about what's going on at this moment in our country, in South Africa, okay? And many things happening, and also talks about what the future holds for this country. Now, there are many people who are optimistic, but there are also many people that are concerned, that are worried about South Africa. And I'm the last person to listen to about politics. So this sermon is not about politics, just to give you a heads up. I'm not going to talk politics. I'll refer to some of the things, but I'm the last one person to say that. But my question that I'm trying to answer is, what does it look like to be a Christian in South Africa? What does it look like? And our passage kind of just touches on some of that today, what we're talking about. It talks about your role as a believer in society. What does it look like, especially now, especially in this moment, with all the uncertainties, with all the concerns, not knowing what's going to happen, not knowing what the future holds for South Africa. And so this morning, I'm asking that question. What does a believer look like? What should he, how should he act? What should he do? How should he respond, regardless of what's going to take place? Now, before I go into my main points, I want to say this. It is important that we don't lose focus. It's important that we don't take our eyes off what is the most important thing, that our eyes will be fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and that our lives will align according to God's will. That's the most important question you should first answer. Now, the first thing I want to look at this morning, I want to start by assuring you that God is above all. No matter how you feel and what you think and your political views or what you believe, I want to assure you God is above all. God's will permeates and supersedes every aspect of life. Every aspect. That includes your life. That includes everyone who lives in this country. That includes politicians. It includes the government. God is above all. And you need to start there. If you want to have a discussion about your concerns, let's begin there. God is above all. Never forget that. If you go to 1 Peter 2:13, our verse this morning, it says, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it to be to the emperor as supreme. Now, for many of us, including me, that's a difficult one. Let's be honest. This is difficult. But when Peter says, verse 13, be subject for the Lord's sake, he calls us to do it not for our own sake, but for the Lord's sake. And by doing so, doesn't mean you are blindly obeying human institutions, but you are actually, in fact, you are recognizing God's ultimate authority over those institutions. You're recognizing, you are putting your trust in God, not in the institution. You're trusting Him, you are believing that God is above all of that and everything is under control. I know it doesn't look like it, but let me tell you, everything is under control. Because God is in control. I want to take you to Daniel chapter 4, verse 34. It's about the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. Remember when he completely went insane and he became a vegetarian? No, he ate grass. Nothing wrong to be vegetarian. I'm not just a... But he lost his mind. And verse 34 says, at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven and my reason returned to me. Let me stop there. I've got this thing come in my mind, this thought. Maybe people will have reason when they start looking up. Just a thought that suddenly came into my mind. But when Nebuchadnezzar looked up to heaven, his reason returned to him. And he says, I blessed the Most High and praised and honored Him who lives forever. For His dominion is an everlasting dominion and His kingdom endures from generation to generation. Verse 35, all the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what you have done, what have you done? None. You see, King Nebuchadnezzar recounts his experience when he lost his sanity. And when God restored him, he knew that God is in control. He acknowledges that God's eternal nature, that He is the Most High, that He is above all. And he says His dominion is an everlasting dominion and His kingdom endures forever. Forever. Kingdoms come, kingdoms go. But God's dominion endures. This is how we should respond. This is how you should respond. When you have your talks, that's fine around the braai. You're halfway to saying if you braai. Okay, you're already there. But when you have your prayer, you have your talks, or you talk to others, this is how you should respond. And I want you to say to the person next to you, His dominion is everlasting. His kingdom endures forever. That's how you respond. Now in verse 35, Daniel emphasizes the insignificance of people on the earth in comparison to God's greatness.
God is above all. He does all according to His will. That should be our focus. That should be our view, our perspective, that God is in control. Do not question His authority. Do not question or resist His actions. Let's not forget that. We get so easily entangled with what's going on the ground level, but we forget. Look up. Because that's where reason comes from. No matter where we live or the political landscape looks like, you need to understand that God is above all. His plans are inviolable. No man can thwart His plans. No government, no ruler, no king, no country, no one. God is in control. God is above all. The Bible teaches us that God sets up and deposes leaders according to His purposes. Now, we might not understand or why, and after these questions, we might not understand how that can be. But at the end of the day, God will fulfill His divine purposes, and human institutions are simply tools in His hands. Simply tools. And He can use whoever He wants to use. He can use the most evil intentions and the worst of rulers, or whoever, rulers who abuse their power. God can use, and if you're a believer, you must know and believe this, for the good. Romans 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose. All things. So let's just get that clear and understand that and get that from foundation that God is above all. It should comfort you. You should understand. As a Christian living in South Africa in 2024, you should have this confidence, not because of what's happening in the political realm, but because God, your confidence is in Him. Knowing that whatever the outcome is, God is above all. His ultimate plan will succeed. His plans are unchangeable. His plans are unstoppable. And no human institution will stop Him. No one. And this is true. Let me say this. This is true of no matter where you live. Now, I don't want to tell people what to do. And I know I've heard some people say, I'm packing my bags. I understand. I've got sympathy. I understand all of that. But let me tell you, there's no place in this world where you will not find problems or corruption or bad or evil. It's the whole world is tainted by sin because people are sinful. Their hearts are wicked. And our focus as a believer in our country, and I'm talking to us, should be the same as in any country. And this is the verse I want to quote this morning, Matthew 6. You know this verse. You know this verse. Matthew 6, verse 31. Is it Oscar? Is it Visakar? Is it? Okay, it's off. Matthew 6:31. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall I eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Let's get our focus right. Let's seek God's kingdom first. Let's keep our eyes on the Lord, Jesus Christ, the finisher, the author of our faith. Let's not forget that God will care for us, no matter what. God and His kingdom, His righteousness, that's our focus. That's what we should seek. Brings me to the second point. And that is the limits of human institutions. You need to understand, and I hear so much, and we've all heard it many times before the election, we heard about this political party or that political party. They are going to save us. Have you heard that? They are going to say, vote for us and we will save South Africa. And you hear that always. That's political speech. Now, I understand why they're saying that. I understand what they're trying to say. They are actually saying, we will save you from the other political party. And I understand not everyone is perfect and not everyone is good. But let me tell you this, there's no political party, there's no person, there's no human institution that can save you. Only God can save you. For those of you who have done membership class, well, remember we spoke about why am I a Baptist? Remember? And we spoke about the Baptist principles. Now, I want to emphasize one of those principles this morning, and I don't know if I put it up there. I think I forgot to put it up on the screen, but oh, it's there. It should be there. I think it's the next slide. This is what we call the separation of church and state. Is it there? The separation, that's one of the Baptist principles. The separation of church and state. And let me read it. It says, in the providence of God, the two, he refers to the church and the state. The two differ in their respective natures and functions. The church is not to be identified with the state, nor is it in its faith or practice to be directed or controlled by the state. The state is responsible for administering justice, ensuring an orderly community, and promoting the welfare of its citizens. The church is responsible for preaching the gospel and for demonstrating and making God's will known in and care for all mankind. That's what we call the separation of church and state. In simple words, it means the state should not do the church's work and the church should not do the state's work. That's in simple terms. It's separate. It's got its own function. God instituted governments and authority for a specific reason, and he instituted the church for a specific reason. Don't confuse the two. Now, the Bible never instructs the church to use all their resources and their energy to reform a country. There's no instruction for us to reform or a state or a country. Instead, the Bible instructs believers to proclaim the gospel and be living examples of the transforming power of the gospel. That is what we instructed to do. Now, when Jesus walked on this earth, he and his disciples operated within a corrupted Roman Empire. I would even argue more corrupt than we have in our own day. More difficult than in our day. Jesus and his disciples did not seek to change the Roman Empire through political means. Now let me just say that there is a place for politics. I'm not against it. There is a place for politics and government and things as God also instituted the government. God has given that there should be a government that fulfills their function and administers justice and ensuring order and peace, like our scripture portion says, and I know they're not doing a good job. But 1 Peter 2:14 says, or to the governors as sent by him to punish, sent by who? By him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. Now that's the responsibility of the government. And yes, I know they're not doing a good job, but our responsibility as believers are to obey the laws, to be a good citizen, to pay our taxes. Yeah? To pay our taxes. And respect authorities. And you may not like doing these things, but again, you're not doing it for your own sake. We're doing it for His sake. And yes, we should be a voice in the world. Yes, I believe we should stand up for Christian values. We should be a voice. We should be the conscience of society. And yes, I believe we should vote for leaders that uphold Christian values. But we should never place our hope and our trust in government to bring morality and godly living in this world. That's not their function. We should not do that. The government cannot save people. The government cannot be the moral compass. The church should be the compass. We cannot place our hope in politics or government. We must place our hope in God. For He is above all. Political activism cannot replace the gospel. The government cannot fulfill the church's responsibilities. It's our responsibility. Human institutions are limited because it's run by sinful people. Yeah. As I say, I shouldn't say political things because I would be my own view and I'm wrong. I'm the bad guy to talk about politics. But on the other hand, our function as church, again, should not be political activism, but should be spreading the gospel and transforming the hearts of people through the Word of God. That's our focus. Transforming people's hearts. That's what we call to do. That's our main focus. That is where we should spend our efforts, our energy, our resources, everything for the saving of souls. Salvation only comes through Jesus Christ, who demonstrated that redemption is beyond human capability, human or economic or political power. Human institutions are limited. Salvation comes through Jesus Christ. Just think for a moment. And when I was preparing, I thought to myself, these people who spend so much money and give so much money to political campaigns, millions and millions, because they believe in that party, they believe in that person, they believe in their views or their ideologies, and they spend so much money, they believe that this is going to save us. And it's so sad when I think about this. Then I ask myself, but what will happen if the people of God believe that the church and God's institution is the only hope for this world and that the only one that can save us? I wonder what will happen if people believe like they believe in politics, when they believe in God that way and His church as much as they do in political parties. What will happen if people give in the same way? Just think. What can the church accomplish? Now, I know God doesn't need money to accomplish His purpose. I'm just saying. Human institutions are limited. God is unlimited. That brings me to the third point, and that's the church's mission. Our mission is to transform the hearts of people through the gospel. That's our mission. That's how people are saved. That's how I would say South Africa can be saved, if people's hearts are changed through the gospel, through the message. Our light shines brighter in the darkness. Our mandate is to spread the message of Christ and live that message in such a way that it would make foolish people, that it will show this ignorance of foolish people. Let me read that again. Verse 15. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. by living a godly life. You see, political reform cannot change people's hearts. Only God's word can change people. And we are called to be a light in the world and the salt of the earth. Matthew chapter 5, 16. Now, I went in a little bit back into church history. And if you study church history, you will learn that Christians actually thrived under various forms of governments. Many forms, different forms, good ones, bad ones. Christians thrived. In actual fact, if you study the history of the church, you'll find that the growth of the church was mostly when the church were persecuted and under pressure and difficult circumstances. Go look at the history. Now, let me give you a little bit of history. Remember 64 AD with the great fires in Rome that destroyed most of Rome, and the Emperor Nero, who started these fires because he had this ambitious idea of building a new city, but unfortunately it got out of hand, and what did he do? He blamed Christians, and then he persecuted them, he killed them, he imprisoned them. Now this persecution created a wave of martyrs, but stories that came out of that was the courage and the faith. In face of brutal death, those stories became testimonies of strength and conviction. It inspired many believers and encouraged others to convert to Christianity. When the world sees that these Christians are being killed and persecuted, but they don't fold. They're doing it for the honor, they accept it for the honor of God. They say, something must be up. This is something I know I want. Many Christians fled, sought refuge in other parts of the Roman Empire, which ultimately contributed to the spreading of the gospel and the spreading of Christianity. And this is just one example of countless examples where hardships and persecution led to church growth. When people saw the courage, the strength of Christians, when they saw the good works of believers in a corrupt world, it silenced the foolish people and it brought public awareness and curiosity among people, non-Christians. Hardships helped to articulate and spread Christianity. That's what took place in the history. Now, if you go to the history of the Baptist Church, I don't know if some of you know the history of the Baptist Church, but it's very rich with accounts, so many accounts of persecution and resilience, which played a significant role in the growth and the development of the Baptist Church for more than 400 years. Now, if you go to the 17th century, Baptists that in England faced the significant persecution in England. Their beliefs and their practices, particularly regarding baptism, yes, baptism, and also the principle of church autonomy, it brought them to a place where they were at odds with the Anglican Church in those days. And the government, which led to imprisonment and fines. An harassment. Now, 1662. Say hello for hello. The act of... ek wil kyk of myne af is van net nou. Kleiner gaan myne ook af. The Act of Uniformity, 1662. You can Google that. The Act of Uniformity, 1662. This act imposed regulations on religious practices, leading to further persecution of Baptists and nonconformists. Many Baptist pastors were jailed for refusing to conform to the Anglican Church's practices, because it was a state church then. Despite these challenges, Persecution often strengthened Baptist communities. Shared suffering fostered a sense of solidarity and commitment to their beliefs. It just strengthens people. And even the Baptists that fled to other parts of the world, like America, you go and read what happened there. They were persecuted. For instance, Massachusetts and Virginia, Baptists were jailed, fined, physically assaulted for preaching without a license or refusing to adhere to the state-supported churches. Now, there's still an ongoing thing in America where you are not, if you're not a state-supported church, they're after you. You have problems. Now, saying all of this, I don't wish suffering or persecution for anyone, for any church. But at the same time, I know in the worst case that God is above all, and He shines His light through the church in the most darkest places. I know that. And I believe that. And the church needs to understand its mission in this world, in any kind of world, under any kind of circumstance, under any form of government. We have to understand that God is above all, and then let us not lose focus on the put our focus on the circumstances, but let us focus on the bigger picture. And know that God uses all things for the good, for the glory of His purposes and His name and His plans. Our role is to honor, to respect, and to pray for our leaders, for our government, to be good. Know that true change, true transformation, begins with the transformation of individual hearts through Christ and the gospel. So let's keep that focus. And I know many of you think that way. I'm not saying that you don't. But let's not lose heart and focus, especially during these days. And I want to close and say this. While we respect and while we participate in politics and political systems, our ultimate allegiance is to God. Our ultimate allegiance is to God. We submit for His sake. We submit, number one, to Him. To Him who is our Lord. And He assures us that He is in control. Our hope is not in our government. Our hope is in the Lord. Our hope is not in politicians. Our hope is in Jesus Christ that saves. And He is, you know what? The Bible says He is the Savior of the world. And as you live out your faith, focus on the transforming power of the gospel. Keep shining your light and do good. Pray for wisdom. Pray for leaders. Be courageous. Be a faithful witness. If things are not turning out as we wish it will, and we must pray that the best outcome will come in the political in South Africa. But however, we should see that as an opportunity to shine our lights, to be a difference, to be that change that the world needs, to be good and do what we have to as faithful citizens. First of all, faithful citizens to the kingdom of God, but secondly, faithful to human institutions. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your precious word. Your word is not distant when it comes to political matters in South Africa, in our country. Your word speaks to us as believers on how to act, what to do, and how to make a difference. And Lord, help us this morning not to lose focus. Help us to keep our eyes on what is the most important, and that is Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. That we will know that your plans are greater, are bigger, more than any man or human institution can ever make, make work or can not even thwart your plan, but Lord, we know that you are above all things and that we can trust you, that we can have faith in you, knowing that you keep us and you preserve us as your children. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have as church to be a difference. And yes, Lord, help us to be that shining light. Help us to preach and share the gospel that Jesus Christ came for them, to die for them on the cross so that they can be saved and that their hearts will be changed. So I pray for our government. I pray for the leaders, for the future government and the leaders of this country, is Lord, that you will change their hearts, that you will save them, that they will have a godly moral compass by which they make decisions. And Lord, that you will lead our church, the church and the churches all around in this country, to be the voice of the word of God, to speak and to know that God is behind and beyond all of these things. And Lord, we just want to do what you want us to do. So I pray that you will give us that peace of mind, that we will have confidence in you, that our hope will be in you, that yes, there are concerns that we have, but we come before you this morning and we say, Lord, we surrender to you, to your will, to your plans, and we know that you are in control. So we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.